Hey, how's it going? Glad you could make it. So I heard you're interested in collecting comics for the first time. Or maybe you've been out of the comic book world for a while, looking to get back in. Or looking to collect some new titles, maybe. Okay, cool. So I knew you were coming. So what I did is grabbed all of the hardcover books, trade paperbacks, and a current long box of, or actually a long box of the current comic book issues that I currently collect. A long box? Yeah, that's an actual long box. That's the actual name. And it's a rigid cardboard box that people put their single comic book issues in to keep them protected, dry, and upright, so they don't bend and crease and things like that. And of course, I also got some boards and bags. I'll give you an idea of how to bag and board a comic, too, to keep them protected. So, that's really about it. I'm going to go through here and show you all the different comic books and talk about the different ones and show you some of the amazing art. And again, this is all some current comic book issues I collect, some current and older trade paperbacks and hardcovers that I think are essential for any comic book collection, at least the ones in my opinion. I don't have every single one out there, but I have a lot of the main ones. I'm not going to go over some of the older comic book issues that are from years ago. I don't really have enough time. Okay, maybe next time you could stop over, we could do that. Is that all right? Okay, cool. Yeah, something to drink? Sure, yeah, give me a second. I got something right here for you. Alright, here's, let me just pour this in a glass for you. There you go. Yeah, no problem. Anytime. Sukasa, Mikasa, Sukasa. My drink too. Cheers. All right. So this is what I was reading just as you came in. Alan Moore's Batman: The Killing Joke, and this is where Barbara Gordon, Commissioner James Gordon, Commissioner Gordon's daughter, gets shot and by the Joker and paralyzed. And in the current DC universe, the New 52, she is now Batgirl, and she's not paralyzed. Now, that created a lot of friction, controversy, but I embrace it. I think it's cool. I try not to take comic books and all that stuff too seriously. I mean, again, it's just art, and it's just something to enjoy. It's some entertainment. But they did it tastefully, I think, and I think it was a success. And I think it's something good, you know. I don't know, but that's just my opinion. Anyway, let's back to this story. So, yeah, so Barbara Gordon, Police Commissioner Gordon's daughter, gets shot in here. And this is just a one-time story, you know, that Alan Moore wrote. Great story, great art. Through here is a little bit of how the Joker became the Joker, somewhat. It tells that story, too. There's Barbara Gordon here, and you can see the Joker shows up. And there she's there. She gets a gun pointed at her. And then she gets shot right through the front, you know, stomach, lower spine. And that's pretty much it. We're only, you know, a few pages in, and that's what happens. And after this, it's mixed with a little bit of the Joker's history, how he becomes a Joker and stuff, and just a great book, great story, definitely an essential, I think, for any comic book fan. And a really good ending too, which I actually don't think I'll show you, so I don't spoil it. Yeah, so definitely essential book. Batman the Killing Joke, the deluxe edition, which I think just means that it's been recolored by Brian Bolland, presenting his original vision of the modern classic for the first time. So, yep, so that's that. All right, sound like something you might want to check out? Yeah, okay, cool. All right, I'll put that one aside. The next one is, I'm a H.P. Lovecraft fan, and Boom Comic Book Studios put out some Cthulhu, however you say it, comics. And this is a trade paperback based on one of the series. It's called The Fugue, and it's just an original story, I think, if I'm not mistaken. If you're a Cthulhu fan, it's definitely different, horrifying, scary, and a lot of interesting artwork, to say the least. Let me see if I can find something in here worth showing you. There we go. And it's, like I said, if you're a fan of Lovecraft, it's definitely something, it's not an essential. It's definitely something worth checking out and purchasing, I would say. Interesting story, you know, if you like interesting, unique stories, it's definitely that. And so that was, yeah, there's a few of these that Boom put out. I think this is the first one. I know there's half a dozen different stories or so, but boom-studios.com, and check that out. You think you might be interested in that? Give it a little thought, okay? Next up we have Animal Man, trade paperback. I'm not sure which issues this collects. Grant Morrison wrote this. And let's see, this is Animal Man number 1-9, back from 1998-1989. And this is not just, who is Animal Man? Yeah, well, he is able to take on the powers of different animals in the environment around him. Flight, maybe, you know, hearing, speed, strength, things like that. But this is a story, he's a family man. And it's not just him being a superhero. It's somewhat a down-to-earth story, and he's not going around just saving everybody. It's different. You know, he struggles with his powers, being a father. I think he actually regrows his limbs there at some part. There's, he gets his arm torn off, I forget how, so he kind of seeks out the worms, because they can kind of regenerate, or whatever. And he gets his arm regenerated. So it's old school art, but it's definitely some different stories in here. But if you want to read up about the history of Animal Man, it's a good trade to have. I think it's somewhat of an essential, especially if you're an Animal Man fan of the current DC universe. It does set his background and what his what he's all about, I guess, pretty much. So it's not too bad. I'm a fan of Animal Man, and I like this. It's Grant Morrison. Of course, you can't really go wrong. A lot of people love him. A lot of people hate him. But he's all right in my book, for the most part. You might be interested in that one, you think? Okay. Swamp Thing by Alan Moore. This is definitely an essential in my book. I love Swamp Thing. It's just so different. Different kind of creature and hero, but not really a hero, you know, somewhat, if you know what I mean. I mean, he's a hero, but he's got some powers and stuff like that, but he's not like a, you know, a Batman or anything. And this is just a very original take. Story origin, I think, somewhat. It's been a while since I read this, but again, it's old school. It goes back to Swamp Thing issues 21 to 27. Copyright 83-84, if I'm not mistaken. Saga of the Swamp Thing, this came out in 87. This came out in 87, but it collects the issues 21 to 27 from 83 and 84. And like I said, it's old school, but it's great. You know, if you collected this maybe when you were a kid or something, and you're older now and you want to reminisce and you know, you don't want to hunt down all the single comic books, but you were a fan of Swamp Thing at one point. Like I said, it's old school art compared to today, but you know, today's will be old school 20 years from now as well. And a lot of good stories, a lot of real kind of down-to-earth stories. Very cool. Not, like I said, not very superhero kind of stories. Just you know, a lot of original, interesting artwork too. A lot of cool stuff. So I think you might want to check that out too. Yeah. Okay. The Watchmen. Everybody loves this. Raves about it. Superheroes, well, I wouldn't say superheroes, but more of a story about people who are heroes, I guess you could say. It's an essential. I'm not a huge fan of it, and it's good. It's a great story. It's all about the story, and the art is good. And it's about these people who are these heroes. They struggle with their heroes, with their identities. They no longer wanted around. Their time was pretty much over, and they try to come back, and you know, something's going on. And like I said, it's been a while since I read it. I didn't even read the whole thing. I just kind of lost interest. But and I know, how could I lose interest in an Alan Moore book called The Watchmen, right? Yeah, I'm a hypocrite, but I don't know what it was about it. Maybe it's because it's kind of old school, the art. That's not really, I mean, I started to read it, but it's really serious somewhat, which is cool. I don't know, I just never finished it, but it's definitely worth having, and I want to finish it one of these days. Again, highly recommend it. You gotta check it out, make up your own opinion about it, but I think that might be something else you want to check out. Yeah, okay. Put that aside for you. All right, so I'm going to let you take all these books home with you. You can check them out on your time and come back and return them whenever you want. All right. All right, now this is an interesting book, Mice Templar. This is really cool, and it's about mice who are certain knights or Templars. Somewhat of a medieval take on mice and the animal kingdom, and it's very interesting, very unique. Written by Brian Glass, who actually lives not too far from me here, great art. I try to hold this at an angle so it reduces the glare for you. And it's about mice there's a certain group of mice that are Templars, you know, knights. And they go at war with the rats. The rats are, you know, the bad guys, pretty much. And great story. Really good story. Good character development, all that stuff. Let's see if I can find that. There's some stuff in here for you to give you an idea of some combat, maybe some art. There's some art here. Interesting. And with these hardcovers comes, you get a nice little bookmark here. And you get some sketches in the back here. A fan work, too, I think. Sketches. You get a little bit of the history from the author. The myth, legend, and the Mice Templar. So, it's good for anybody who's a fan of the book. Definitely worth, I would say, an essential, because it's unique, because it has great stories, and there is blood. These mice don't mess around. They fight, and they will kill you, and the rats will put you on their pike. Put you on their pike if you mess with them. There's a the rats here. It's not just, you know, cutie mice. It's cutesy mice. It's cool mice. So that's one. The prophecy. Number one. And we have 2.1 and 2 of Destiny Part 1, Destiny Part 2. And I think I didn't read these all yet, because I've just got a lot going on having a kid. I have to get to these someday. Of course, I bought them mostly for him, and he really liked the prophecy. He was 4 years old when I bought this. Three and a half, four. I really liked that. I was reading that to him. And these two books I just haven't got to, but again, they're, I would say they're essentials. It's great art. And great stories, so you can't go wrong with those. And they're independent, you know, Image. It's a local guy, so you're supporting somebody, you know, not a necessarily a big name DC person. And of course, a Harvey Awards winner for the second books. So what do you think? You want to check these out too? Yeah, sure. You can take these too. I'll borrow those. All right. Now I'm going to get into Hellboy. This is a trade paperback, The Seed of Destruction. And Hellboy is definitely an essential comic book to have. This collects issues... This volume collects issues 1 through 4 of the Dark Horse comic book series Hellboy, Seed of Destruction, and stories from San Diego Comic-Con Comics No. 2 and the Comics Buyer's Guide. And if you don't know anything about Hellboy, it's just an amazingly illustrated book. Character, what the heck is going on here? Oh no, my bind is destroyed. Boy, that's not cool. Oh well, anyway, not sure how that happened, but oh boy, if you've seen my big hardcover Hellboy page turning video where I do nothing but leaf through that, then you know what I'm talking about. This is just amazing, and it's got some Lovecraft, Cthulhu-esque story, story and mythos to it. And if you don't know, Hellboy was a little Hellboy boy. I don't want to say creature, but that was brought into this world. By the B.P.R.D., the Bureau for Paranormal Research and Development. I don't think they were called the B.P.R.D. at the time that they brought him into the world, but there was a evil guy, and I forget his name because I'm not as well read on Hellboy, on the main Hellboy guys as I should be. Again, it's been a while, but casting a spell for the Third Reich. Back in World War II, I think it was, and these bunch of evil occultists brought the Hellboy child into this world. They didn't know it. They thought their spell failed, and the good guys picked him up, and he's been working, trying to fight evil bad guys and all that, monsters and stuff. So definitely, you want to check this out too? Okay, yeah, sure. Put that in your pile for you. So, like I said, Hellboy, definitely worth collecting, too. Not just the old trade paperbacks, but the current series too. It's ongoing. B.P.R.D. This is the Bureau for Paranormal Research and Development. This is a spin-off of Hellboy. I think Hellboy came first and this came after, but I was not collecting Hellboy in the B.P.R.D. when they first came around. I only found out about Hellboy when I was out of the comic book world for a while. I collected comics back in the 80s, and I stopped for 20 years until I had my son. And I got back into comics so I could collect them and pass them on down to him, you know, 20, 30 years from now. But, and of course, too, you know, I guess I'm living somewhat vicariously through him in that regard. But, you know, it's not something I force on him, but we know we read comics together from time to time. Anyway, I'm rambling. BPRD is a spinoff of Hellboy. It's the cast of characters that support Hellboy, and they work, again, kind of like what Hellboy does, but Hellboy's usually not in these books. And they go around, you know, fighting bad guys, monsters, and things like that, and a lot of great stories. This is a great book. This is kind of like called Plague of Frogs 1. And let me see what this collects. I think this collects, this volume collects stories from Hellboy, Box Full of Evil, Abe Sapien, Drums of the Dead, BPRD Hollow Earth, Dark Horse Extra, BPRD The Soul of Venice, BPRD Dark Waters, Night Train, There's Something Under My Bed, and Plague of Frogs, series issues 1-5. So it's like an anthology, somewhat, a lot of different BPRD stories, all of which are great. You really can't go wrong. There's a couple of volumes like this. I'm not sure which volume this is, this is one of them. You get some bonus material at the end. Crazy mushroom looking creature guy. All about these evil beings. Again, Mike Mignola, I think, might have been somewhat inspired by Lovecraft stuff and Lovecraft stories. So a lot of that otherworldly monsters and gods kind of in the BPRD Hellboy mythos. So you want to check this one out too?
Sure.
All right, so I don't know if you've seen my video. I did a video about this. Nothing but page turning through this book. No whispering, no talking, and it was just to show off this amazing volume. Seed of Destruction, Wake the Devil, Hellboy. This is beautiful. It's like felt material, well-constructed, great bind. Just a massive book. It's quite heavy. And this is the story of Hellboy. Beginning of when he comes, when they summoned him. You see, here's the evil occultist. Again, he probably says his name here, but I can't think. Working for the Third Reich. Sorry for the glare. Trying to bring Hellboy into the world. Doesn't happen like they think. But then he appears here in this, I forget, somewhere. And they say, look, it's a little boy. And he says, Professor Brunholm, I think his name is, says, Hellboy. And there it is. He becomes part of the group, the army, you know, some of the army guys, soldiers. And Brunholm, whatever his name is, I guess. The professor kind of guy, the doctor kind of guy. If you've seen the Hellboy movie, it's the guy that kind of raised Hellboy, you might say. And then it's just from there on out, it's a lot of awesome... story and art. And if you've never collected the Hellboy comics from back when, you know, amazing stuff, then you might want to pick this up. Like I said, this is an essential if you want to know this story of Hellboy. A lot of great art in here. And Mike Mignola is just amazing artist. And good story, too. That's a great story. So Hellboy, Volume 1, Seed of Destruction. Again, highly recommended. Well, you want to check that out, too? Sure. I'll put it here for you. Looks like your pile's getting huge. All right, finally. Last, but definitely not least. And probably the best for last, of course. This would be a tie between this and Hellboy. Is The Walking Dead. Current paperback, trade paperback collection. Of every, let's see, number 1 through 15. Wait a minute. 16. Where's 16? 16? Oh, there we go. Hey, look, it's backwards. 1 through 16. Right to left. Anyway, that number 1's on the top when I lay it down. Yeah, so this is the Walking Dead comic book in trade paperback form. Through issue 1 up through issue number 96. With volume 16. So there's 96 issues. And that's the reason why I only collect the trade paperbacks, because I only found out about The Walking Dead, I guess 2 years ago when I got back into comics. And that was at up at issue number 70 at that time, before the TV series came out. And all 70 issues were selling for like $100 or something like that. It wasn't, or $200. And I contemplated getting them all, but I thought, you know, that wasn't that important. And the next thing you know, there's announcements of the TV series, and that thing just skyrocketed. I mean, the number 1 issue just went to like $100 or whatever, and the whole series went $500-$700 or something like that for all the whole run from issue number 1 to 76. I can't remember, but I remember looking on eBay, kicking myself for not buying the entire run before the television series was announced, but that's fine, no big deal. And anyway, so yeah, I collect only trade paperbacks now. And if you don't know The Walking Dead, The Walking Dead is an amazing illustrated and written comic book, not just about zombies, but about people in this zombie, somewhat post-apocalyptic world, overrun by zombies, where, as you know, if you may or may not know, I'm not going to spoil anything for you as to why there are zombies. But it tells the story of a guy, of a cop, who has a family, who got shot in the line of duty, woke up out of a coma, somewhat like, what's the movie? I can't think of it anyway. And finds the world overrun with zombies and starts looking for his family and everything like that. Just amazing writer. It's all about character and story, this book. There's zombie killing, and there's zombies eating people. But that's not what this story is about. It's not just a horror book. It's a real-life drama in comic book form, and it's amazing. I just can't speak highly enough of it. So this is Volume 1. Days gone by, and I'll just show you the scene where he gets shot down the bottom here. And then he wakes up from his coma on the second page. So it kind of gets you right into the comic book. And from there, it's him looking for a nice good old zombie eating somebody scene. Awesome stuff. That's Volume 1. Volume 2 is miles behind us. Volume 3, Safety Behind Bars, when they go to the prison for the first time, which is coming up this year, 2012, Season 3 on AMC. Volume 4, The Heart's Desires. Volume 5, The Best Defense. Volume 6, The Sorrowful Life. Volume 7, The Calm Before. Volume 8, Made to Suffer. And if you don't know what happened to Michonne, she gets her revenge in this book, in this or the comic book that this trade paperback covers. I'm not going to spoil anything for you. You're going to have to check that out. But she gets her revenge. Volume 9, Here We Remain. Volume 10, What We Become. Volume 11, Fear the Hunters. Volume 12, Life Among Them. Volume 13, Too Far Gone. Volume 14, No Way Out. Volume 15, We Find Ourselves. And lastly, Volume 16, the current one, as of the date of this video, which is September 2012, A Larger World. Just amazing, really. I mean, I can't wait to reread these. Yeah, so you want to check these out too? Sure, no problem. You can check all of them out. Put them in your pile for you. There you go. Essential for any comic book fan, The Walking Dead, seriously. If you're not a horror fan or a zombie fan, I can understand that, but I think if you're a comic book fan, you gotta look past that stuff because, you know, it's, I don't know, that's just my opinion. All right. So, why don't we check out the long box that I have that has all my current issues in it, okay? And then I can loan the long box to you too, all right? Take that with you, and you can look through them and read them whenever you want and just bring them back when you're done. All right, let's just take off the lid. And then here's the lid to the long box, just so you know. And let me lift up the long box while we're at it and show you. See, there you go. All the comics go in here. And fill up. You keep them upright. And it keeps them dry. You can keep them up on top of something. And it's a great way to store comics. And I'm not sure how much the box goes for. $5. There's a sticker on there. 5 1/4. Alright, so I'm just going to go through here and we'll check out all the current issues of the comic books that I currently collect and highly recommend. So, first up, we have in alphabetical order, American Vampire. Amazing, amazing. There's about, what are we up to now? Issue 27, 29, issue 29 or so of this amazing, amazing comic, American Vampire. Written by Scott Snyder. This has won some awards. As that tells you right there, not necessarily that every comic book writer who doesn't win an award isn't good, but it just, you know, kind of backs up his repertoire, I guess you would say. Scott Snyder also currently writes the current Batman, and he writes Swamp Thing? No, he writes Animal Man, I forget, offhand. And also he writes Sweet Tooth, I think it's called. I don't collect that. I don't really know what that comic book is about too much. But anyway, American Vampire. If you want to collect a comic book about vampires, this is the only one that you need to collect, in my opinion. It's raw, it's gritty, great story, great writing, great characters, and a completely new take on vampires. Vampires that can walk around in the daylight. Vampires of different ethnicities, some cultures, so to speak. Vampires at war with one another. So I'm just going to walk through all the titles for you this time. And maybe next time what we'll do is we'll spend a little time together going over each single issue comic book that I currently collect. And, you know, go through, open them up and look at each issue. I'm not going to have time to do that with you today. All right, is that cool? All right, thanks for understanding. All right, so again, just some great storytelling, great take on vampire mythology. And if you're a fan of, I guess, scary horror, you know, it's cool. It's got a lot of good stuff in it. Let's see. Vampires, I believe, during the war. During the 60s, just all throughout time. It's really, really cool how this was written. And let's see if I have some that are not in there. Yeah. Give you an idea of what the writing and story is about. Or the art. The art, at least. I don't really have time, sorry, to read to you. The stories. I've got so many comics to go through, but let me see if I can get, there you go, a taste of the art. All right. Just great, great stuff, really. Great, great stuff. So, I didn't collect this when it first came out, but I recently, I actually had to go and get the older books on the secondary market, so I currently collect this now. So I'm missing a few titles. I have most of them for the most part, but there's some that I need to collect. So, alright, so that's American Vampire. Hopefully you got a decent taste on what some of the artwork is like, and let's see if I can show you something else in here. There you go, some more. There you go. So it's great, and it's not just about, you know, vampires killing each other. It's really good story. People, regular people, getting turned into vampires and how they deal with it, and things like that. So it's kind of like what The Walking Dead is to zombies. Scott Snyder is to vampires. So put these back in the box. Then, like I said, you can take the box with you and bring it back anytime. All right, next up is Animal Man. This is an awesome comic. Again, as I said earlier, based on it's a Family Guy. Not the Family Guy. A family man. A guy with a family. Someone like me. But he has powers. I don't. He's tapped into what's called the Red. DC, the New 52, brought Animal Man and Swamp Thing back on the shelf. Which is awesome. And created this entirely new mythos of the Red and the Green. The Red belonging to the animal world. The Green being belong to like the plant life, and it's like this essence, this whole kind of like this web of life, is what the Red is, and he taps into it, and he's able to tap into the powers of animals around him to gain his powers. And what's going on right now is this battle between the Red, the battle between the Red with the, what's called, I think it's the Black, or what's called the Rot. The Rot is like death and decay. The Green, the Red, and the Rot, it's like the balance of life. They stay in balance, but sometimes one gets more powerful than the other. And currently the Rot is trying to take over the world and make everything like a dead, decaying world. And just the writing is not only awesome, but his daughter has superpowers, or the same kind of powers somewhat. But the artwork in here is phenomenal. Animal Man is by Jeff Lemire, so Scott Snyder is the one that does Swamp Thing. And all these are bagged up, but I'll open one up for you. I'll open up the first one, just to give you an idea of the artwork involved in these books. And it's just amazing, amazing artwork. I mean, I could draw anything or illustrate. That's what I would illustrate. That's what I would love to illustrate. Look at that. That is amazing. Phenom all the way around. And this is right up here, if not, in my opinion, better than Batman. Of course, nothing really beats Batman in the Bat books, you know. But this is right there, pushing for the lead, in my opinion. Just amazing story about what they're going through, he's going through, you know. It's kind of a retelling of Animal Man, too. So, this is the Animal Man annual, where every year someone gets to write a book on Animal Man. They're called annuals. Usually I'm not sure if it's always the same person that writes the annuals, that does the actual stories, but I'll try to go through these here for you. All right. Just great art, great story, really. Highly recommend it. Unlike a comic book hero or a comic book character, unlike any you have ever seen. And unlike anything that's between Swamp Man and Animal Man, unlike anything you've seen in the comic book world. All right. Oh, Aquaman. So. All right. You want to check these out too? Look, again, I'm going to keep them in the box. And next up we have Aquaman. And you may not be familiar with Aquaman. Yes, it's the guy that controls creatures with his mind, telepathy, sea creatures. I don't know what happened to my Aquaman number one. I'm pretty sure I have a number one, but it's not here. Anyway, another great story, great character. You know, he's got like super strength. He's got telepathy with animals. He's the king of Atlantis, from what I understand. Again, I'm not the greatest expert on Aquaman. But they brought him back to the shelf, and just fantastic art and writing too. Definitely something that I highly recommend. I'm only showing you things that I recommend and I currently collect. Great stuff. And let me show you some of the art here. Yeah. Let's see if I can get some of the art inside. If I can find a good, here's a good spread. And it's still Jeff Johns writing this. And if you don't know, Jeff Johns has written some great, he's a great writer for DC. And you can see there's Black Manta. So this is a typical comic book hero, but excellent. All right, next we got B.P.R.D. Now I only recently have been collecting every single B.P.R.D. issue that comes out. Like I said, this is up to, like, they're up to the 80s and 90s now, so this has been going on for years, so I can't collect every single one. That's why I've got those BPRD hardcover volumes that I started collecting. And then at a certain point, I started collecting the comic book issues themselves. Again, BPRD, it's usually mini-series, little stories that come out once a month, either a one-shot, one story. That's all it means. It's a one-shot. That story is to that one issue. That's it. Or there's a little mini-series, anywhere from 3 to 5 issues. Again, essential for any comic book collection, I think, in my opinion. I don't really have any limitations. If it was up to me and if I had the money, I would collect every single comic book out there. Unfortunately, I don't have the time or the money, and I've limited myself to the DC Universe. But not mostly DC Universe. As you can see, I collect American Vampire, which is Vertigo, actually. I think that's part of the DC Universe. Yeah. Or DC Company. But, you know, there's Hellboy and The Walking Dead. I was collecting some Marvel stuff, but unfortunately, like I said, I had to cut down my the finances. Anyway, so we're talking about B.P.R.D. And there's this whole thing called Hell on Earth, and I got into this a little bit late, so I don't exactly know what's going on, but there's Hell on Earth. There's all kinds of crazy stuff going on Earth in the B.P.R.D. universe. Sorry if my fingers, this is just great. This little mini series here. The contrasting colors in some of these scenes in this book. Look at this. That is amazing. I love it. Mike Mignola, John Arcudi, James Harron, and Dave Stewart. I mean, this is two creatures just going at it, man. And it doesn't get better than that. It's just amazing. This little miniseries, The Long Death. I don't want every comic, I don't need every comic book to be like that, because then you would just get desensitized to it. But it's nice to see once in a while that kind of artwork and story. Yeah, you just never know what you're gonna get with B.P.R.D. What kind of creatures or they're gonna come up with in the Hellboy world, and I'm not really sure what direction this Hell on Earth is going. But it's all these little mini stories within, and that's where we're currently at. We got no exorcism. Oh no! Right now there's the B.P.R.D. I don't have it right here. The Return of the Master. I think that's what's currently going on. I have the first issue of that. Batgirl. Just to give you some idea of her. Her comic books. All right. Again, Barbara Gordon shot. But DC retold her tale a little bit and brought her back. One thing about long boxes, the comics always seem to fall. So I should have a number one in here of Batgirl. I don't know where it is. Oh, there it is. Number one. So you can see she's like free from her wheelchair. That's pretty cool. Batgirl. Again, highly recommend it. Yes, it's Batgirl. I collect Batgirl. I have no problems with that. Gail Simone is the writer. She's in my opinion, a critically acclaimed writer. Some good artwork in here. Alright, so that's Batgirl. Again, highly recommended. Let's see, we got Batman. New 52, Batman. Essential. How can you not have Batman? Hold on a second. Cooperate. Okay, there we go. Batman. And in this, Scott Snyder and company, again, Scott Snyder, who does Swamp Thing and American Vampire, created this new mythos about the Night of the Owls. Court of Owls. And it's this whole new enemy, this whole new mythos that they just excellent, that dates back in Gotham City, way back, and how they created these people, these twisted people, created these undead or regenerating killers, assassins that keep Gotham City in check. They go after the people in power, and they're ruthless. Gave Batman a good fight, and what a way to start off the new 52. And if you don't know what the New 52 is about, basically DC took a lot of old characters that haven't been on the shelves for a while, a lot of new ones, and kind of retell their tales a little bit, modernized them, made them more contemporary, so to speak. I think they did a great job with it. I think kudos to DC for that. So that was Batman. Great stuff there. Again, Quarter Owls, just fantastic. A whole new mythos to be explored there. Batman and Robin, father and son. Damian Wayne is Batman's son. The son of him, Batman, Bruce Wayne, and Talia al Ghul. And it's basically he was born and raised by Talia al Ghul and the Assassins, the League of Assassins, that's it. League of Assassins, Ra's al Ghul's League of Assassins, raised, he and she, Talia al Ghul, raised Damian to be a killer. And Batman is now his father, and Damian is struggling with what he was trained with, being a young boy. I think he's 10 years old, and you know, he's young and he's got a lot to prove, and he's still got some instincts to kill. And Damian and Bruce is trying to show him what it takes to be a real, you know, hero, so to speak. And it's great. And of course, I'm a father and I have a son, so for me, it's this hits home with some of the story in there. But whether you're a father or not, it's definitely a must have. All right, we've got Batwoman, and Batwoman is an awesome, amazing story, and I will tell you, it is. Kate Kane survived a brutal kidnapping by terrorists that left her mother dead and her twin sister lost. Following in her father's footsteps, she vowed to serve her country and attended West Point until she was expelled under Don't Ask, Don't Tell. So she's a lesbian. Now she's many things: estranged daughter, grieving sister, proud lesbian, brave soldier, determined hero. She is Batwoman. She's unique, she's powerful, she kicks ass. Great art, great writing. And it's cool that DC Universe is showing support for the LGBT community by having a lesbian comic book hero. And I think that's great and commendable. And I have no problem with that, you know. It's great art in here. They changed artists at some point through here, and I'm not sure why. There was, let's see if I can get Batwoman in here. Here's some music with an example of Batwoman. They changed artists because I think there's a disagreement between the artist and the writer or whatever. So, something like that. So. Just, again, another comic book I highly recommend. She's not young. She's very mature, smart. She's funny. You know, they have a lot of just great character moments in this book. Blue Beetle is about Jaime Reyes or Jamie Reyes. I think it's Jaime. J-A-I-M-E, I think. I think he's Hispanic, which is cool. Another non-white mainstream kind of, you know, most everybody in the comic books are white, you know, for the most part. So it's cool to see the DC break out a little bit and change things up a little bit. And this is a retelling of his story a little bit. About the scarab that comes and implants itself in his spine, very, very cool story. Really cool character. He's a young boy. I'm not sure if he's in college or if he's in high school or something like that, but he's young. And he's dealing with life and, being a young man and having these superpowers. So it's definitely very cool. And some of these are not bagged and boarded because I need to catch up and read them. Catwoman. Fantastic. I mean, you gotta own this. The artwork, the character, and the writing are great. A lot of a tempestuous relationship with Bruce Wayne, Batman. She is not just she's not a bad person. She's a thief. She's a criminal. But she's a good person there. She was born into a hard life, and had to make her way, and that's what she does. And it's a really good character, character-driven book. I definitely recommend it. Some interesting scenes here. Very a good scene between her and Batman. But I'm not gonna. I'll have to do it when you come back and we look at just Catwoman together. I'll show you. I'll go through all these issues so you can see the artwork up close and personal. And I'll just give you an example of some of the artwork in here for her, since this one is not bagged. Just give me a second. All right. Let's see if I can get a nice Catwoman. There's a decent illustration of Catwoman in here. Not so much in that one. Let me get this one real quick. Just give me a second. Sorry. Let's see. Catwoman was a good scene here. I know. Yeah, here we go. This is good, I guess. Yeah, this will do. So here she is. But awesome book. I love the character. I love the art. And yes, I show it to my 4-year-old, 5-year-old son. Well, he's 5 now. So, and we read Catwoman together. But there's the one scene between her and Batman. I haven't really showed him that. So, you got Detective Comics, which I still collect, but I've missed a couple couple issues. Detective is really more of the detective side of Batman, though. It's hard to explain. It's great. It's essential. It goes through all of Batman's villains. I haven't got a chance to read it like I wanted to, and show you, or see for myself. But it's definitely. Written by Tony Daniel, written by Tony Daniel. It's great stuff, though. That's an essential. The Flash. Flash is amazing. Great story about a guy who's got superpowers, but he's a bit of a hero, but he's not like. He does go up against some of his rogue gallery guys, but he's like a regular guy. Works in forensics lab for the police department, I guess you would say. But it's illustrated, amazing illustrations with how they show how he's tapped into the speed force, where he gets his speed powers from. Again, a very good character driven, very good character story. Here you can see the Gorilla City characters he's back in touch with, reintroducing those. Here's the Weather Wizard and Heat Wave. I think that might be a new character. But I'll show you some of the illustrations here and show you how the Flash moves around. It's beautiful art, just amazing. Francis Manapul, what he does with the Flash there. Frankenstein and Agents of S.H.A.D.E. This is like a horror superhero monster book, like one of those old-time monster flicks or whatever you would say. It's got that feel to it. And this is very interesting. And Frank, yes, it's Frankenstein, and he's a good guy, and he's got a sword, and he's like from the medieval times or whatever, and it's just so different and unique. It's got to be in your collection, I would think. I mean, I love it, and I collect it, and I read it, and it's definitely different. It's a monster book, you might say, and I don't know how else to put it, but they go against some very different creatures and good stories, interesting characters, a little bit of humor in it. Gives you an idea about the art. The art's not too bad. I wouldn't say the art is stellar. It's different. It's good. It's gritty. Definitely monster art. Alright, we got some Hellboy in here. I already showed you Hellboy. And of course we have the Justice League. We have the Justice League. And they brought them back. Actually, the Justice League has been around, but they started over because DC New 52, like I said, they kind of went back in time a little bit. They didn't really erase any stories or anything like that, but they kind of retelling the formation of the Justice League and how, while Batman is pretty much established as Batman in the new 52, he's a little bit younger somewhat, but Justice League is pretty much bringing together for the first time Wonder Woman, Superman, Batman, The Flash, and Green Lantern, who's very cocky, and Batman, who's like this misunderstood hero, and Superman, and nobody knows who they are and what they're doing and their powers, and but they brought together to fight Darkseid, I have read this for a little bit, but I'm missing. I have number one. Where are all my Justice League books? I have number one and number two. I have number one, I think. I'm missing number two. Where is number one? Yeah, no, here's number two. Oh, okay. All right, let me start over again. The Justice League. Like I said, it brings together all the different heroes for the first time. Jim Lee's art. Geoff Johns is a great writer, of course. Jim Lee's art is not bad. I'm not a real great fan of Jim Lee's art. And I don't know how to put it. It's like blocky or chunky. It's very... I just don't know. It's not smooth, crisp. I don't know how to put his art. So I'm a little turned off by Justice League from the art side, from the pencils. Not so much the coloring. A little bit of the coloring, but something doesn't sit with me 100% with this, as with all the other comics. So I do, again, highly recommend it because it's the Justice League. It's the main group of characters brought together, working together. I'm not sure. I'm sorry. Did I stop flipping through this for you? So I kind of stopped reading it, but I was missing some issues and for some reason. I know you're probably like, how can I stop reading it and then recommend it? Well, you know, it's the Justice League. It's Geoff Johns. I mean, that's enough said, but I don't like to pick up in the middle of a comic book run at start issue number four or start number one and then miss two and three and read number four and five. I like to make sure I'm reading everything sequentially. And I was missing two and I was missing something, another issue, and that's why I stopped reading. For the most part. Alright, last two books. Nightwing. Dick Grayson. This is the second Robin, because the first Robin was killed by the Joker. Joker blew up the first Robin, and can't think of his name, in a building in some other part of the world. So Dick Grayson was raised on the circus, his family, became Batman's became second Robin, but then he kind of grew up and matured and wanted to do more than just be Batman's apprentice or sidekick, and he became Nightwing. They brought him back, and just amazing. I mean, he's not a young guy so much. Yeah, I'd say he's in his 20s, I think. Younger than Batman, but he's a badass. And great writing, great character stuff. He's already established as Nightwing, I believe. I can't remember from number one and number two, but for the most part, he's already been established as Nightwing, so he's not learning to be Nightwing again, or they're not retelling his origin. They touch on his origin a little bit in here. I think they retell it a little bit. I can't remember offhand. Again, this has got to be in the collection if you're a Batman, a fan of the Bat books, I think. And of course, he goes up against the Court of Owls. All right, before you go, I know you've been here for a while, and I appreciate it, and before you go, I have, last but not least, The Swamp Thing, and written by Scott Snyder, who does, like I said, American Vampire and Batman, and illustrated by Yannick Paquette. Amazing, amazing character, story, and artwork. If you can just look by the covers here. Story of a guy who was doing a experiment trying to create a bio-restorative formula that would heal people or something like that. I can't remember. Killed in the fire. Fell into the swamp where his house was or his home was. And the swamp brought him back to life. This is pretty much picks up on that. It retells his origin a little bit differently. And of course, he is also battling the rot. So the Swamp Thing and Animal Man are somewhat using the same mythos, the red and the green. And they're both fighting the rot, and there's going to be this big crossover, and there's going to be a new event where they fight the rot. And just to give you an idea of the artwork, amazing, great artwork in here. Again, essential comic book. I think for anyone that collects comics, and it's definitely something that's worth collecting and reading, and just some amazing, amazing art. Number one reason, because I'm a visual guy, I'm all about the visuals, I'm all about the art first, and story is second. Story's important, but story is second to me, unfortunately. Not unfortunately, that's just how it is for me. I'm a story guy. I don't read books. I like visuals. That's just how I am. Doesn't mean I think story is any less. I think they're equally important. So that's it. So what did you think about all the comics? You want to check those out? You might see something in here that you might be interested in. Cool. And like I said, you can borrow them and check them out and bring them back anytime. Last but not least is boards and bags. And what you do is you with your comic book issues like this, you see here, you put this, slip it into a bag, and then put the white border in the back, the backing board, and that keeps it rigid, keeps it from bending, helps protect it somewhat, and the bag helps it slow the oxidation process, and that's basically helps the pages from becoming oxidized quicker, protects them from any water, anything would happen like that, they go for about $10, so about $20, but if you don't collect too many comics, that will last you a year. Like I said, there's 100 backers. There's 100 backers, 100 bags. So however many comics you collect a month, tally that out. Now that's how many bags that you'll use. All right, so like I said, thanks again for stopping over. I'm glad I could show you my collection. I hope you found something that you might be interested in. And if you are, let me know. I'd love to hear about it. And next time, I'll start, we'll go through each one of the issues and look at them more closely. Read from some of them, and we'll take it from there. So thanks again for stopping by, and take care. Cheers.